Good morning. Welcome to worship here at Braddock Street United Methodist Church. My name is Kirk Knave. I'm one of the pastors here. Here at Braddock Street, we seek to be followers of Jesus who love God and worship, love others in small groups, and who serve the world in mission. If you are new to us, there's a green card in the pew racks. We really would encourage you to give us some contact information so we can take a moment later this week and get to know who you are, get to know you a little bit better. If you're new online, there's a digital sign-in card for you. Welcome to those of you who are online. Please interact with us. Say hello. Put up a little heart when something touches your heart. We love to see those. We want you to know that you're a part of our worship service as well. And now let us continue in worship as we sing together, God is on the Move.
Scripture. This morning's scripture is from John chapter 14, verses 8 through 19. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. The word of God for the people of God.
Okay, we want to invite the Humphreys family to come forward right now. And boys and girls, if we can make a little extra room right here. Yeah, so the family can come in here and stand around. It's not just one child that's going to be baptized, it's two. And you all get to watch that as it happens, up front and personal.
All right, we are so excited to see you all this morning, and we get to have the honor of baptizing both of these wonderful little boys today. So, brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth by water and the Spirit. This is God's gift offered to us without price. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, please say, I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, please say, I do. And will you nurture, do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, please say, I do. And will you nurture these children in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, they may be guided to accept God's grace for themselves, to profess their faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? If so, please say, I will. Beautiful. Okay.
Baptism is something that we do together as a church, and so there are vows for you as well. Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? We do.
We do.
Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life, and include these two now before you in your care? With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness, that they may grow in their trust of God and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them, that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life. And as a symbol that they can take for years to come, we light these candles, symbols of the light of Christ that will live in their hearts by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And they will always remember that these were lit during their baptism. Oh, we both need our hands free.
No.
I was about to hand her all these things, and I realized we both need our hands free.
Yeah, we got two of them.
And to make sure we've got the right one, what name is given this child?
August.
August Dennis. We need more water, August.
There we go.
August Dennis, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let all God's people say,
Amen. Good job, buddy. All right.
Your turn.
Tread. Hello. How are you? And what name is given to this child?
Logan Austin.
Logan Austin, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. There you go. Amen. Good job, guys. Look at you. I
want to invite the congregation to join with us in singing one stanza of Jesus Loves Me, This I Know. Let us join our hearts in prayer. Almighty God, today you receive August and Logan into your family formally. They will always be Humphreys, but today they take on the name of Christian. They are Christ's. They are his own. So we pray for the power of your Holy Spirit to guide, protect, and to shape them as disciples of Jesus every day of their life. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, boys and girls, I know that happened to a number of you as well. Today we heard Jesus talk about the Holy Spirit. You just heard me mention that during the baptism. It's God's power of the Holy Spirit that initiates us, that brings us into God's family. I've got something here that is very special to someone. What do you think this is? It's a blanket. It's not a very big blanket. It's not something I sleep under, but there's somebody in my house that uses this blanket, and I've got a picture of her right now that we'll put up on the screen. This is our puppy, Abby. Everybody wants to know, what kind is she? She's 27 different kinds. We did the DNA test. But every day that my wife and I go away to work, we have to leave Abby in a crate. Do y'all know what a crate is? Yeah, some of you. And she actually likes it because it's a comfortable space. We give her a little treat when we leave, of course. But I hate to leave her. And so this is one of her blankets that she sleeps on during the day. It's got our smell on it. Smell's really important to dogs, and it's also got her smell on it, so she knows it's a safe space. You heard in the scripture Jesus say to his disciples that he was leaving them, but he was going to leave with them an advocate. Sometimes we call that a comforter. Sometimes we refer to this person as the Holy Spirit. And to make it really simple, the Holy Spirit is God with us. Even, he says, you know him because he abides with you and he will be in you. This Holy Spirit is God's presence, the presence of Jesus, the presence of God the Father, even inside of us. It's that close, like a very warm, comfortable blanket. So even when you might feel alone, maybe your parents aren't with you or you're off to camp or overnight or something, and you wonder, am I alone? Remember, like a warm, comfortable, protective blanket, God is with you no matter what. Okay? Let us pray. God, thank you for being with us always, especially when we might feel alone. Remind us that you are with us to guide us, to protect us, and to comfort us with your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So now you can go to Children's Church, or you can go with Miss Jeanette over, yeah, to Children's Church, or with your parents.
Daddy.
And now we want to take a special moment in our worship service to remind you that through your giving, you make everything in our church happen. And that includes our music ministry. And just before they start to play, during as we take up the offering, I want to give George Amos, our director of music, just a chance to introduce you to these wonderful folks who are singing for us every week.
Well, as you know, we don't really get any time off. You see us during the summer, so these people give their Thursday nights up all year long, unless something happens like Monday, Thursday, and we just have to adjust. But they adjust their schedule. They do a wonderful job. They're very dedicated. So from your left on guitar is Bill. Then next to him is Jason. And then some singers this morning, we have Megan and then Anna. And then behind them, do I need to say it? No. Alan, our drummer. Great. And we have some people that are not here with us today. They actually had some things to do. Sarah, our bass player. One of our singers, Lindsay, is Taylor Swifting it this weekend. And then another person who's not up here, but she is in the house, I believe, at least she was earlier, Emily. Wave, Emily has a newborn, so we'll give her a couple more weeks.
Thank you.
So we appreciate them, I appreciate them, and we thank them for what they add to our service.
Music speaks to the heart, and just so you, this is a reminder, all this equipment and our live equipment, as well as our handbells, our organ for our other services, all that is possible because of your generosity, so thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, you all, for all the amazing work that you do every single week to make sure that we are led so beautifully in worship. Thank you. I keep forgetting I'm short and I have to come up another step, don't I? There we go. Good morning, everyone. My name is Annalise, and I am one of the pastors here at Braddock Street, and I'm so glad to be in worship with you all today. This morning, we are going to finish up our sermon series that has been titled Because He Lives, where we have been thinking about all of the things that we are inspired to do because of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Would you all please pray with me? Holy God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, Lord our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. So, quick question, show of hands, how many people in this room love Jesus? Yeah, that's pretty good. There we go. That's awesome. Now, in our scripture for today, we are told that if we love Jesus, we will keep all of the commandments. So another show of hands, how many of us have kept every single commandment? Actually, before you answer that question, how many of us can name every commandment by heart? Anybody? I'm not just talking about the Big Ten. I mean all 613 that are in the Old Testament, plus all of the ones that Jesus remixes for us in the New Testament. Anybody? No, me neither, actually. And on top of that, you know, we all know there is a difference between knowing something and doing something. So for me, I happen to have all of those Ten Commandments memorized because I had an amazing Sunday school teacher when I was little who taught me a song so that I could remember them, and it got me extra credit in a class in seminary once, which was awesome. I wrote her a thank you note, and I'm a millennial. We don't do that, okay? I took the time to write her a thank you note because she got me extra credit on that test. Luckily for you, because it's Music Appreciation Sunday, all of these people are amazing, and that means I am not going to ruin it by singing for you instead. So you're gonna have to imagine the Ten Commandments song, okay? But how in the world are we supposed to keep all 613 of plus of these things if we don't even have them all memorized? We don't even have a way of knowing all of them. And then we're also supposed to keep them? And let me just go ahead and make a confession right now. I definitely don't even keep the Big Ten super well all the time, if I'm honest. I am coveting every single person who is watching this online right now in their PJs instead of having to be up super early to be here on time this morning. So, even standing here, I have not completed the assignment, right? But luckily for us, Jesus helps us come up with the beginnings of the answer to this question. How do we keep all of these commandments if we can't even remember all of them? And he does this in Matthew chapter 22, verses 35 to 40, when this exchange happens. And one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest? He said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Jesus summarizes the whole of the law, all 613 commandments, plus all of the teachings of the prophets, into two things. That's a lot easier to remember, right? Love God and love your neighbor. That's how he does it. So I want to test this theory. Can we put each of the commandments into one of those two categories? Does everything fall under love God or love neighbor? We don't have time to do all 613. So what we're going to do is look at the Big Ten. So the first four of the Ten Commandments are no gods before me, no idols, no taking the Lord's name in vain, and to keep the Sabbath. All of those can fall under the category loving God. And then 5 through 10 are honor your parents, no killing, no adultery, no theft, no lies, no coveting, which would all fall into the second category, loving neighbor. Okay, so Jesus' system works, and while there may be some in that 613 things that we might debate over what category they should go in, basically everything fits into these two things. System works, but still, perfect love of God and neighbor, that is the definition of someone who has reached Christian perfection. And all of us are taught from when we are little, we are sinners, every single one of us. None of us could raise our hands and say we kept all those commandments. So how can we possibly get there? According to one of the founders of our church, John Wesley, the answer is through the work of the Holy Spirit, which brings us back to our scripture that was read for us today. In John chapter 14, verses 15 to 19, it says, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him or knows him. You know him, because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I'm coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live." The Holy Spirit is that advocate that Jesus promised us is coming to show us the way after he returns to the right hand of the Father. That promise has been kept. We have the gift of the Holy Spirit. And it is in this beautiful Trinitarian promise that we learn a bit more about how to accomplish this goal of perfect love of God and neighbor. And it starts with us cooperating with the work of the Holy Spirit. Through the work of this great advocate, we are able to move towards that Christian perfection. And we don't go on this journey of sanctification on our own, because another gift that Jesus Christ has given us is the gift of the church. As the church, we are the body of Christ, and we are connected one to another in many ways. We saw just a moment ago what it means to be connected through our sacrament of baptism. We also experience this bringing together of the whole, this connection through our sacrament of communion, because each one of us literally takes a piece of the body of Christ into ourselves, and together as the whole, we make up the whole body. And then there is that thing that connects us from the moment that we are born, which is that every single one of us is a child of our Heavenly Father, who knit each one of us together in our mother's wombs. When we embrace this connection to God and our connection to one another, not only do we move closer to that perfect love of God and neighbor, but we also begin to make sense of another part of the passage of scripture that we read today. "Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it." Now, these verses and several others throughout the Bible have often been taken grossly out of context and have led to people getting into some pretty dangerous theology. First of all, people think that this means that God is some kind of divine genie, and that if you pray hard enough, you will get the things that you want. Not only does that mean that there are people who believe that they can control God, which is kind of ridiculous, but also it means that if you don't get what you want, then you just don't have enough faith. which leads to some really bad lines of thinking. For example, something like, I am not in this horrible financial situation because of bad financial decisions I've made, or terrible circumstances in my life, or society's failure to provide an adequate safety net, or even the failure of society as a whole to fight against our greed in a capitalist system built on exploitation. No, it's none of that. It's just because I didn't pray hard enough. That's my problem. Now, this line of thinking also leads people to believe in things like the prosperity gospel. If you don't know what that means, it's this weird belief that if we are faithful, God will bless us with money, and therefore people who have money have been extra blessed and must be extra faithful, and all of us can get there if we just pray enough. If we donate enough money to somebody else, then God will bless us back in return. And there are many, many people who have been duped by this lie. So prosperity gospel is one of those things. Another one is faith healers, right? People who believe truly that just putting your hands on somebody and praying is going to do something like take away a horrible diagnosis or disability. Not quite the way that works either, is it? And then there are people who will trust those preachers that say that they can do things like pray to raise the dead, or even take a venomous snake bite and survive. And I just want to say this very clearly. These things are not real, they do not work, and God is not actually a genie. Good? We all good? Everybody with me? Thank you. That also doesn't mean, though, that our prayer or our work is useless, because Jesus made us a promise. And that promise is that as the body of Christ, we can collectively perform miracles by following the commandments to love God and love our neighbor. And together we can move on towards that perfection. And while we're on that journey, we will heal each other, and we will shelter each other, and we will feed each other and clothe each other and house each other. We'll befriend the lonely. We'll bring the outcasts back into the fold. We'll learn to stop being so judgmental and to leave all of the sorting out to God, because it is God alone who can change hearts and minds. The only thing that we can do is encourage people to learn what that love of God looks like because of the way we love them. For many of us, it is us. It is fellow Christians who will be the first ones to express how much God loves someone to them. And if we treat them poorly but say, God loves you, what does that mean? So the way that we treat folks, the way that we love them, is a testament to how much God loves them, and that is how we bring new folks into this promise and have other people experience the love of God. In the past month or so, a little longer, we have started a new small group, which all of you are invited to. Like, seriously, please, I would love to bust the walls out of that room because of there are too many people coming to this Bible study, okay? We meet at 6:30 in room 135 on Monday evenings, right as Monday night dinner is ending, so you can come and get a meal and then come on down the hallway for Bible study. This has been a commercial, and I expect to see you all there. Because of this class, I have had the opportunity to go to Monday night dinner every single Monday for about a month and a half now. And through that, I'm starting that process of building relationships with our guests that are there consistently, basically every week for most of them. And I have learned so much just in that short time. I have a lot more learning to do, but still, that's a lot of experience just in this month and a half. There are so many folks in our community that are struggling. We have done a lot of amazing work in this community, but the shelters are filling up. The hotels and motels, even at discounted rates, are not affordable people. And there are more and more and more and more people living on the street or out of their cars in this community every day. I cannot tell you how many phone calls we get every week from individuals who are in need. And what we do is say, okay, here is a list of all of the amazing resources in our community. Please go check out all of these people because they have what it takes to take care of you. But still, people will fall through the cracks. So I want to tell you a story about a woman that I met at Monday night dinner, a little bit about her situation and the conversation that I had with her about it. This wonderful woman has recently been kicked out of her house and then also kicked out of the motel that she had moved into and then once again kicked out of that motel into the street, into her car, which she then lost. And so now she is effectively completely unhoused. And I sat across the table at dinner from her and she cried and told me, "You have to help me figure out what to do with my precious animals." She had two cats. Where were they gonna go? And so we talked about options for what we could do through her tears because those cats are some of the only family that she has left. But I went through the list in my head of all of those amazing organizations that we are so honored to get the opportunity to partner with. And let me say, before we go into this next slide, these organizations are amazing and they do great work, and I am not disparaging a single one of them. There's just more need in this community than they can even meet. So I want to explain what it was like to sit across from her and go through her options together. So I started with the place that I tend to start with folks and asked, "Have you been to CCAP?" The Congregational Community Action Project, and she said, "Yes, I've been over there. They're really great. They don't do housing. They can't help me." That's true. "Have you been to the Laurel Center?" "Yes, I have. It's full, and they only take women and children who are in situations of abuse." "That's not me. I don't fit the criteria, so they can't help me either." "Okay, what about the Salvation Army?" "Yes, when it isn't full, I could probably get in there, but the problem is they require ID." "Okay, so bring your ID with you." And she said to me, "I don't have it." After all of those evictions, being kicked out of various places, having the little bit of stuff that I have just completely destroyed when police raided our campsite, pepper sprayed everything. So what I did have, my ID, the important documents, have either gotten stolen or destroyed or lost in all of these moves. So I can't go to Salvation Army because they won't take me in without an ID. All right, what about Winchester House? "Well, they only do housing for people in a certain age bracket category. I don't fit it, so they can't help me." "Rescue Mission? Well, it fills up really quickly. And while they're doing some really amazing things to help expand it, it doesn't actually help with me because I need something right now at this moment." All right, what about Habitat for Humanity? "They cannot build houses fast enough to meet the need. They're working hard. They do amazing work, but they can't help me." Family Promise? "Well, they're new, they're wonderful, they're gonna fill a need that we really have in this community where we're gonna be able to house whole families together instead of them having to be split up. But here's the thing, they're just getting started, and also the line, the proverbial line to access their services is out the door and around the corner. They can't help me either." "Okay, what about Watts? The Winchester Area Temporary Thermal Shelter. We love them. They do such amazing work in this community. Is there anything they can do for you?" "I mean, yes, if I'm in a situation where I don't have shelter in extreme weather, I can lean on them. But the thing is, the word temporary is in their name. I'm not supposed to go there to find a permanent place to live. They just keep me from dying on the street, which, thank you, but that's not really gonna help me either." "Okay, have you talked to other churches?" "Yeah, I have. I talked to a lot of other churches, but just like Braddock Street, most churches have limitations placed on how much money they're allowed to give out to individuals. And those rules are important. They keep churches from getting scammed. They mean that people are allowed to make sure they're being really good stewards of the money that has been given to them. But it also means that right now, with so many people in need, my name's pretty down low on the list. I just got into this situation, and there are a lot of other people who've been waiting for longer than I have for services." So do you see what this vicious spiral looks like. This lady is doing her due diligence. She is showing up everywhere that she's told to go check out, and every single place, in her case, isn't able to do what she needs in the long term. It's a really vicious cycle. It's hard to get out of. But I'm not going to leave you in this hopeless place right now, because the good news is that we have the good news. Anybody? You see what I did there? Good news is that we have the good news, which is the gospel. No, nobody with me. They didn't get it at 8:30 either. It's not your fault. It's a bad joke. Maybe I'll take it out before the 11:15 service. But anyway, the gospel of Jesus Christ tells us that God's love for everyone, is what led the Son of God to come to earth as God with skin on, to experience life as we do, while teaching us how to live a better life. And then he became the ultimate sacrifice and took away the burden of our sin so that we could have a new chance every single day to learn how to better love God and our neighbor. And together, we have been promised by our Savior that the power of God's love that lived in him was transferred to every single one of us while he hung on that cross. Because Jesus lives, we can face tomorrow. Because Jesus lives, our fear is gone. Because Jesus lives, our fear that this world will forever be sinful and broken, and a place where we can harm our fellow creations, that fear is gone, because the love of God wins this battle, and we know that. That fear has been replaced by the mercy and the grace and the audacity of God's love. And together, we are the body of Christ, and there is nothing that Christ, God, who lived, God who died, God who lives again, cannot do. Would you all please pray with me? Holy God, today we come together to celebrate the fact that you rose from the dead. You broke the power of sin and death, and throughout your life, death and resurrection, you teach us every day how to get better at loving you and loving our neighbor. Today there are many people and places and things on our hearts, and we lift all of them up to you, but we also say a prayer specifically today for mothers. We pray for those who have been wonderful and successful mothers. We pray for those who have lost their mothers, and for those who have wanted to be mothers but have not been able to. We pray for those who became mothers unexpectedly and who rose to the challenge, and for those who could not do so. We pray for mothers who have lost children, and for all those who celebrate, and all those who mourn, and all of those who will do both of those things today. And we pray all of these things in the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen." I invite you all to stand as you are able and join with us in our final song, Life Song.
Thank you.
thank our band one more time, please? Thank you for being in worship today. It has been an honor to be able to worship with you. We want you to know as you leave, the United Women in Faith are still collecting funds to help us be able to put together 800 hygiene kits that we can send to folks in need. And so if you have the ability to help them out there at the table right back there in the corner in the gathering space, we hope you will take advantage of that. Now, hear your benediction. Now go in peace to serve God and your neighbor in all that you do. May those in this world to whom love is a stranger find in you most generous friends. And may the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. Let my love